Ali, thank you for joining us. This is our final presentation. It's going to be awesome, Ali. We're very excited. Me and Miguel have seen this video, so we're excited to have this live commentary from Ali Abdullah from Diamond Denim to talk through his meal. And we thank you for this as well. And like, Ali, just like before we begin, how new is your meal? I know your family's been in the textile business for generations. And so how new is this denim meal that you guys have got?
Hi, thank you for having me. The mill itself is about, the denim portion of it's about six or seven years old. What we have to show today is a little bit of the whole process. So starting from spinning to the garment, the spinning is newer. The spinning is about 2 years old. And the garment process is about 3.5-ish years old. So denim is the oldest part of the chain.
It must have been really fun making this meal and having the engineers and designing it. I know that part of it is always quite fun for anyone involved. I'll stop talking. I think it's important that we play your video.
Thanks. So, hi, my name's Ali. I'm from the team at Diamond Denim. We're based in Pakistan. We're going to try to show you as much of the denim process as we can on Zoom. It's not the easiest of things to do. These are some brief shots of our factory, some brief aerial shots. We're based just on the outskirts of Lahore. These are some shots of a small cotton field that we have in the factory. It's not ready for commercial production, more for show. This is a real cotton field, not our own, but just to give you guys a flavor of how we collect the cotton. The cotton comes in and goes into the cotton go down in bale form, in compressed bales. After that, they go into the spinning section. Just to sort of briefly talk you through this process. So the first step in the spinning process is the blow room. This machine called the Blendomat effectively picks up the cotton from various bales laid out on the ground. The purpose of this is to blend the different bales so that we get some uniformity in the yarn. And one, if there's one bad bale of cotton, it doesn't impact the quality. From this, we go into the next machine, which effectively blows air into the cotton, fluffs it up a bit. Can we pause here, please? Cleans out some of the contamination on the previous process, and then we come into the carding. And the carding process basically makes the fibers parallel, eliminates short fibers, so it lines up the fibers, eliminates some of the short fibers, and makes something that we call the sliver. The sliver is being rolled into the cans ahead. Then it goes into the drawing process. The drawing process effectively makes the yarn a bit more, makes the sliver a bit more, let's say, rigid, makes it a bit firmer by passing it through some rollers and applying some pressure in it. So then we go into, after the drawing process, we'll go into the combing process. Combing is not always required. It effectively just takes out even more short fibers and makes the yarn smoother and stronger. But in denim, we generally don't use combed yarn a lot. These are some shots of some slivers after combing. Then we go to the simplex. The simplex effectively introduces twist into the yarn, makes it a bit thinner. It's still sliver, after which we go into the ring. The ring is the main process where we basically add the counts, lub, lycra, and convert them to bobbins, which you can see on your screen. Then we take them to the outer corner, which sort of combines all the bobbins onto a cone. Splices them together and sort of puts them into the cone form that we're used to. After that, on some yarns, we need to condition it. So we apply some steam so that it relaxes, especially when there's some lycra stretch in there. This is just a brief snapshot of that. That's the end of the spinning process. So it's packed. Usually in-house, we transport in pallets. Externally, we sell however the customer needs. It goes through a quality check, various physical tests, visual tests, as well to ensure that it's of optimal quality before the next process, wrapped around a blackboard to check visually whether there are any naps or not, goes through an Ushna test, strength tests, and whatnot. So the first process of the denim, we start over here, the ball warping. So just to briefly introduce you to the denim process, each cone from the spinning mill comes on and is loaded onto this machine called the ball warper. The machine at one given time can take our machine can take up to 528 cones at a time. Each of them are then individually brought forward and wrapped around. We basically converge them together into a rope form, and we wrap them around what we call a ball log. They go into the next process, which is called rope deck. We're effectively making a rope so that we can take it into a form that it's easy to dye with indigo. So it's just being wrapped around the ball over here. We've got three of these machines in our factory. Then we go to the rope dyeing machine. This is the creel, the end loading section. It's got about 72 places where we can load the ball logs. 36 for running and 36 for loading for the next production run. This is a brief snap of the whole machine. It's a pretty long machine at about 100 meters. So we've got about 4 wash boxes to start, 10 indigo boxes, and 4 wash boxes at the end. Various chemicals and processes are applied. The yarn's dipped into the indigo, squeezed, and then goes up in the air to get some oxygen. That's how it fixes and just goes back in. And the number of boxes we use varies. The next process is rebeaming. We effectively take it out of the cans. After rope dyeing, it goes into cans. And now we're re-wrapping the rope, converting it back into beam under tension now so that we can make it suitable for weaving. So the ropes we made in ball warping, we dye it, and now we're effectively bringing it back into a weavable form that we can now take to the sizing machine, where we apply starch, usually in denim, but there's various other chemicals we can use to strengthen the yarn because the weaving process is pretty brutal. So we need to strengthen the yarn, and we then combine all these yarns onto one big beam so that we can make a fabric, take those 528 ends and convert them into, say, 4,000 ends for the fabric. Then we move into the weaving process. It's relatively straightforward from what it looks like. The yarns loaded onto the loom, weft yarns inserted on from the side, and we have fabric. Sounds a lot simpler than it actually is, but it's a slow process. So we need quite a few machines. So in our denim production, we use about 130 machines to do it. There's various types. So there's air jet insertion and rapier insertion, depending on the strength of the yarn. Then we go into the finishing process of the fabric. The first step in the finishing process, there are various processes that we go through. But the first step that we go through is the singeing process. And you'll just see the singeing machine coming up. On this machine, we're effectively burning off fluff and excess fibers on the surface to make the fabric look a little clean. It's a very high uniform flame. And because it's a flame, we need to pass the fabric through very, very fast and then cool it down very rapidly to ensure that it doesn't catch fire. So here you'll get a brief look at what the flame looks like. You on the video, you just don't get a sense of how quickly the fabric is moving, but it's an essential process to make jeans look the way they look for us today. After that, we can go through various processes. We can go through a stentor to control the stretch on the fabric. We can go through a mercerizer to give the fabric some luster, to flatten the fabric, as we call in the industry. We can over dye the fabric on a patch team. This is a picture of the mercerizing machine. There's various finishes and various processes depending on the product. The final step of the process is the sanferizing process, in which the machine will just come up shortly, where we control the warp shrinkage of the fabric. So generally, when we're stitching the fabric, we don't like to have the warp shrink more than 2-3%. So to keep the fabric stable, that machine should just, that's the sanferizing machine. So it's effectively a rubber belt just pushing the fabric together, pushing the weft ends together to make it a bit more uniform. Then we go to the inspection frames, where we mark defects. It's fabric, we always have defects. So we mark them, we cut them out, we optimize a cut plan. At the same time, you'll see a little bit later, the fabric goes into physical testing in the lab. So it's visual inspection and physical testing. And then it's packed. and warehoused, and then either sent loaded into a container to export or to move it within our own garment factory. That's an auto packing machine where we effectively just throw the roll in and it packs it. That's simple as that. And then it's going to be loaded into the warehouse. There we go. So forklift edge of lifting it up. We can stock about 3 million meters of fabric at any given time. We usually don't like to have as much, but we do need the capacity because we're storing for our apparel division and our fabric division. A brief look at the lab in the denim division. Various tests, mainly to do with strength, color fastness, light fastness. That's a tensile test machine where we're pulling the fabric apart to see at what strength it breaks. First step of the apparel process now, the CAD department, where we make the patterns. Then we spread the fabric out onto spreading tables. Sometimes we need to relax the fabric depending on the nature of its stretch. We need to let it naturally shrink a little bit. Then we go to the cutting process. The pattern comes from the CAD team. It can be cut automatically using a machine like the one you can see on your screen right now, or it can be manually cut. After which, sometimes we go into an embroidery process where the back pocket is sometimes embroidered, as you can see in this shot over here. Then we go into the sewing process. The sewing lines can range from 40 machines a line to 80, 90 machines a line, depending on order size, efficiency, what we're looking for, what product we're trying to make. We keep changing these. We have an industrial engineering team that sort of runs these calculations. Since we're dealing in bulk quantities, our factory has quite a bit of automation in it. As we'll see on the coming machines, this is an auto pocket setter. It's usually a 4-person process, but we've been able to bring it down to 1 person, where he effectively just lays the panel on the table and the pockets lifted and stitched onto the back panels. This machine is called an auto serger, where it's effectively, we just put the panel down and it puts a serge stitch on the seam of the garment so that there are no loose threads. That's a J-stitch machine, where we're automatically attaching a J-stitch to the fabric. And then we have belt loop, the waistband attacher, where we're attaching the waistband. It's not quite automatic, but it definitely assists in the process. Then we have the belt loop attacher, where we're attaching the belt loop. We're hemming the bottom over here of the pants. All of this is tracked through a production monitoring system based on RFID that helps us track the most efficient and most inefficient processes. We're also able to track quality, as you can see on this screen. We're able to track efficiency. Then we go into the garment processing part of it. There we have a laser room where we're able to laser instead of dry process. We also do dry process manually, so hand scrapping, but we prefer to use the laser wherever we can. So as you can see on the screen right now, there's the manual process being applied. Then we have the washing machine, the wet process, various processes we can apply. So the stone washers, there's stone washers, and this is a hydro extractor where we're effectively just wringing out then there's the garment drying, where the garments are dried, and then go into the finishing process where we attach the buttons, attach leather patches, cut off loose threads, repair any damages done in the washing process. We attach the labels, iron them. There you can see the leather patch being attached. cleaning up the belt loop stitches, so cutting off loose threads, ironing the garments, measuring them to make sure they meet the measurement standards of the customers, attaching labels, quality checking them, just making sure they're of top quality to go to our customers, go through our standard inspection process. And this is an interesting process where it goes through a metal detector to ensure that there's no needles left on in the garments. And this is we call this the metal-free room, where it comes, passes through that metal detector and then is packed into bags over here before they're now put into cartons and stored into the warehouse. So just a brief shot of that process. Shot of the warehouse, garments are loaded into a container and off to the retail stores. This is behind the scenes, there's a lot going on to make even the factory run. This is a picture of the boiler house where we make steam to dry the fabric. There's various fuels we use. We use biomass and natural gas as primary sources. This is a powerhouse where we're generating electricity for the factory to ensure it's uninterrupted supply. The weaving runs 24/7. We cannot afford any power disruptions. So that's a pretty big setup to generate about 11 megawatts of energy in order to do that. One of the most important parts of our plant is the effluent treatment plant, where we treat all the water before we let it out into the municipal drain. We're now working on water recycling. We're effectively, in this process, getting rid of oils, cotton fluff, chemicals, decoloring the water so that it's in a similar condition to what it is when we put it into the process. And the next step is, and that's an investment we're making right now, is to recycle this and to put this back into the process so we can lower our water footprint. Thank you very much. That's a brief, short tour of our factory. Not the easiest thing to do over Zoom, but we've tried to do our best.
A great video. Your video was amazing. And you did such a great effort by filming all these processes for us. Right, Miguel, wasn't it amazing to see?
Absolutely amazing. I mean, I think we had the last discussion, 1 week ago, something like this? It's already made. It's wonderful. Please.
I've got a question. Obviously, I know I'm a bit of a denim nut. I wear raw denim. And I know I remember when I started my career 20 years ago, it was all about ring and unsanforized fabrics and loom state. Nowadays, obviously, those sort of options are open. Obviously, there's some customers, I'm sure, that might ask for unsinged fabrics, maybe, right? So you're very flexible as a factory, depending on the order, right?
Absolutely. So most of our customers ask for singed and sanforized fabric. But we're going through a trend where vintage denim is becoming more and more important. The Levi's look is coming back, and so we're seeing more and more demand for unsinged and unsanforized. We have that flexibility.
Nice. I'm going to look at the question, and I'll let Miguel ask another one.
My question, Ali, is that some people may think that a denim mill is a dirty, full of water, a lot of fluff floating everywhere. And we see diamond is like a hospital, right? It's white, clean, no water and everything. So denim is not dirty business. I mean, it's not dirty business, at least for responsible mills, okay?
Absolutely. It can be very clean. We try to keep it as clean as possible. We try to be as responsible as possible. And it's always, it's a journey that we're going through, and we need to keep improving. Like, for example, a few years ago when we started, we had the water treatment plant. Now we're going to, in the near future, going to be recycling our water so that we're taking less out of the environment. We're also investing in renewable energy. So we're making investments in wind power. We're making investments in solar power so that we can lower our carbon footprint in that element. So it's a continuous improvement process. We try to be as clean as we can. It doesn't have to be dead, to answer your question.
It's very commendable. I think, you know, the fact that you're already future-proofing yourself, even though you're such an amazing company anyway, you're still going ahead and putting all the investment in for the next 10, 15, 20 years. Some questions that have come through that are interesting. what kind of weave's the most popular that you weave in your company? Is it probably a 3x1 right-hand twill, I imagine, right?
Absolutely. So a 3x1 right-hand twill is the largest by far. The 97-98% of our production goes into that. The dobby weaves are becoming more and more trendy, but the 3x1 right-hand twill is and always will remain the most popular weave.
Okay, and a question from Hannah. Would you recommend using laser to wear out garments over manual techniques? How much benefit is obviously with laser, it's less people involved, I imagine. It's less harmful. If it's in a closed environment, it's fine, right?
It's less harmful. The skill on the laser is, there's a different skill set required for manual hand scrapping and for laser. For laser, you need a very good a designer to make the patterns really well so that they don't look artificial. For hand scrapping, you need a very skilled guy who also doesn't overdo it and can sort of replicate. Now, hand scrapping always has some benefits in the sense that each garment's a bit unique because no two garments can be exactly the same. But with laser, you can get reproducibility and you can get more productivity, less people. And also less harmful, potentially less harmful, depending on the, but we take precautions even for our hand scrapping. So there's pros and cons to both. I think the future is laser for reproducibility reasons and for efficiency and cost reasons.
I think the way to look at it is maybe the people that are really good at hand scraping should be the ones that are learning how to do the laser so that their knowledge is passed on to that other technology because they know how a garment should look. So we should be training those people to do the laser patterns. I'm just going to read another question. Thank you so much. Very interesting. Oh, Gabby, our friend Gabby, who used to be at sort of Ravensbourne, clear presentation. Thank you. Okay. Maddie's also saying some nice things as well. Kathy, apologies. Oh, everyone's just having a nice chat. They're just saying how nice the video was. Miguel, any further questions for Ali? Ali, you did a fantastic job.
There's a quick question asking for how long it takes to produce a pair of jeans.
I didn't
take that one. The yarn takes about 10 days on average, 7 to 10 days.
From bale to finished yarn.
So the yarn itself takes a couple of days to start, but the whole order will take about, if it's say a 50,000 meter order or a 50,000 piece of jeans orders, it takes about 7 to 10 days for the yarn. About 30-ish days. Between 25 to 35 days for the fabric, depending on the fabric, depending on the weave, depending on how dense it is, and about 40-ish days for the garment. So from yarn to garment, it takes about 90 days conservatively. But
so obviously, there might be customers that order a Tencel or a hemp or a lycra, so you have to order that in advance. That's why there's lead times, isn't there? Like 2 months or whatever it is, or 30 days or 45 days. That kind of process.
Absolutely.
Yeah, nice. Miguel, any further questions?
Yeah, it's one of the other things that a denim mill should have is flexibility because, well, it's about the fibers, it's about the shade, it's about the construction, you know, the density of yarns, it's about the washes. So you have to be fast, efficient, and flexible all at the same time. Not easy.
It's not easy. And it's such a big operation, Ali. Obviously, engineering, obviously your family been in the trade for a long time, but as I said, it must have been really fun doing this. I know your cousin's got a mill as well, and they hired Japanese engineers to make their factory. So I guess you did the similar thing. You got a Japanese engineering team to probably help you.
Yeah, we had an Italian team. So
the Italian team.
Not bad.
You got the right people to do it. That's what I'm saying. It's like you got the specialists to help you, the right people to help you to engineer it and to make the factory and the floor more efficient. So yeah, amazing.
That is an art.
Ali, you've been fantastic. It was a big responsibility we gave you, and you delivered so well. It's going to be very hard to top this video for the next person who's going to do any kind of live video. You did a really fantastic job. Thank you.
Excellent job, Ali. Very, very appreciated. Very much.
Amazing stuff. So, Ali, we'll see you again soon, and thank you so much.